How would I define hip hop?
It's fun, it's beautiful, and it relates to everybody.
Hip hop to me is back in the days.
First thing on your mind, last thing on your mind.
It's mine, whatever I want to make it.
Style of dress to the music.
Dance, it's a way of talking.
Desire to be rich.
It's the way you perform in bed.
Hip hop is freedom, if you ask me.
A big melting pot.
It was an alternate to being in the gangs.
To me, it's a form of poetry.
It's like the minority is the majority.
It's not just, you know, little kids spinning around on cardboard and listening to bebop music.
Hip hop was my womb.
Hip hop is a culture.
It's like the mothership, and I'm just one of the little sailboats, you know, riding the wave.
The voice of America.
It's a beautiful thing,
and I love it.
In about 4 seconds, a teacher will begin to speak.
From the family tree, you won't school.
Cause I grab the mic and try to say yes, y'all. The microphone fiend.
Welcome to Grab the Mic, MTV's 20th year anniversary celebration of hip hop. My name is Sway, and right now we're in New York at the Virgin Megastore, where as you can see, they have a very healthy selection for hip hop music, which is kind of hard to believe because the voice of America was just a whisper coming out of urban centers like Philadelphia, Chicago, LA, New York, and Oakland when MTV premiered just 20 years ago. Now hip-hop is worldwide and has become a pop phenomenon, and that's because no other music speaks to young people so directly and profoundly than rap.
Let's go.
Rap is full-blown right now in the whole world. If you really look at it, if you took rap away from the world would be nothing right now.
You have different aspects of hip-hop. You have your southern hip-hop, East Coast.
Cause you know you ain't got much longer to go. The quicker you go depends on the stronger the flow.
You have West Coast. I guess that's always been the case.
I won't even say your own name when I come around.
But I think Midwestern hip-hop is moving towards the spotlight now. You have your different styles. You have hip-hop that's like really lyrical. You have hip-hop that's more into the production. Like, you got all kinds of
You got everybody from, like, Outkast, obviously, the Mysticals.
Danger!
You know, Snoop's still ringing his bell. Him and Dre, they still doing their thing over there. Jay-Z still doing his thing. Cash Money people, they put it down. It's a beautiful thing right now, you know, because it's employing a lot of young people who might not necessarily be doing a lot of positive things at this time.
Now it's business. Hip-hop is a business right now, which is good because it puts a lot of black people on behind the scenes, owning labels, producers, engineers. There's so many jobs, you know, so many things you can do because of hip-hop. A lot of people are eating.
When you go to a hip-hop show, usually no matter whose show it is that's big in hip-hop, you're gonna see all kinds of races, all kinds of different fans.
Nowadays, everybody wanna talk, but they got something to say, but nothing comes out when they move their lips. It's a bunch of gibberish, and my guys look like they forgot about Dre.
Now we can pack stadiums, you know what I'm saying? Hip-hop music has the power to do that.
You got kids who grew up on rap. Kids who don't know nothing but white, black, no matter who they are, all over the world, you got kids loving rap music. Limp Bizkit, the Kid Rocks, even groups like Korn, you know, are highly influenced by rap. So it's all over, and it doesn't do nothing but get bigger and bigger.
Right.
No escaping this. No escaping this.
Worldwide.
No escaping.
No one's better with us.
There is no denying hip-hop's presence on MTV now, but it wasn't always this big. In fact, when MTV first hit the airwaves 20 years ago, the artists who dominated the channel were either new wave, punk stars, or late 70s rock superstars.
I'm old enough to remember MTV coming on as a rock channel, and it was strictly rock and roll. And just to see a black face, period, on MTV was something that was out. Unheard of.
However, thanks to a Lower East Side punk band, a nationwide introduction was made to an emerging trend coming from the streets, parks, and basement parties of New York City called hip-hop.
Fat Five Freddy told me everybody's fly. DJ spinning, I said, my, my.
Man, that's hot. Blondie score, you know. Come on, man. Everybody in the hood, everybody knew that song. That was a stepping stone for hip-hop. It was like, for real, yo. We could do this.
MTV was only on cable at the time, you know, and cable required money and stuff like that, you know, so we didn't have too many cables, you know. It probably was like one or two people on the whole block who had cable, you know, and they probably had it illegally.
Cable? Growing up, there was no MTV. I mean, MTV came out when I was like 13. I want my MTV.
Herbie Hancock's Rocket video helped ease MTV into the hip-hop game, so much so that he cleaned house at the first annual MTV Video Music Awards.
This is number 5, I think. Tonight, I'm really shocked.
And it goes a little something like this.
Yet it was a rap trio from Hollis, Queens, who were transforming the world of hip-hop, and pretty soon they would do the same for MTV.
2 years ago, a friend of mine asked me to say some MC rhyme, so I said this rhyme I'm about to say. The rhyme was death.
How'd it go?
This way.
Run DMC became the first rap act to achieve regular rotation on MTV and took rap music out of the city and into the suburbs for the first time.
A good way to demonstrate all the super deaf rhymes that I create. I'm a wizard of a word, that's what you heard. If anything else is quite absurd, I'm the master of a mic, that's what I say. And if I think a thing, that just say it anyway.
We want to take rap and make it a part of other music. Like, a lot of the other the singers and stuff, they
think
of us kind of, you know, it's from the street, it's not going nowhere. We just want to be able to sit with them at the Grammys. You know, we make rap as music. It's a part of music now.
This speech is my recital. I think it's very vital to rock
a rhyme.
That's right.
On top.
It's tricky. It's so tight.
Here we go. It's tricky to rock around, to rock around. That's right. On time. It's tricky.
They're the Rolling Stones of the rap guy.
The wanted man from the wanted clan, wanted by every fan across the land. G-A-N-G off the street, R-U-N-D-M-C complete. Who's that?
They were the pioneers of modern day hip hop. Before Run DMC, you know, rap was rapping, breaking, graffiti. You know, all that was together. Run DMC made rap emerge out of, you know, the hip-hop culture to be the, you know, the signature art of hip-hop.
We're Run DMC, gotta be to the settle. He's not handle, he's not brittle. Jay's a winner, not a beginner.
They took hip-hop to a level that I don't think nobody's ever taken it to this day or ever could take it any further than they took it. Compared to where it was, where they brought it to, you know what I mean? I don't think anybody could ever take their crowns on that.
After the break, the Kings of Rock take rap music to the mainstream. And hip-hop finds a home on MTV.
It ain't even got to be nobody on there. It could just be Ed and Dre, you know what I'm saying? And you still watch it, to watch the videos, to watch what them clowns gonna do.
That was the first time you saw a hip-hop artist doing something with a rock band, and it was like, man.
It was just the perfect thing, you know, and it's been done so well since then. It was just a great honor to be a part of that.
Welcome back to Grab the Mic, MTV's 20th year anniversary, a look back on hip-hop and rap music on MTV. I'm Sway, and right now I'm standing at the entrance of Washington Square Park, smack dab in the middle of NYU, where over 15 years ago, rap moguls Rick Rubin and Russell Simmons came together to form Def Jam Records. That was extremely monumental. But in 1986, it was Rick Rubin that masterminded a collaboration between a veteran rock band and the world's biggest rap group.
At that time, people didn't think of rap music as music. And I thought doing a cover of Walk This Way would be a really good idea, because here was this Aerosmith song, which was pretty much a rap record already. We didn't really change it very much to make it Run DMC's version. The vocals were already done in kind of a rap style cadence. It already had a breakbeat for the intro. So the purpose of Walk This Way was to kind of show that this musical form that people thought wasn't music really isn't that different from stuff that they're already familiar with. It made it more palatable to them.
duet with Aerosmith let people know this is nothing that you have to be afraid of, and it's also a true form of artistic expression. It was so pivotal for both their careers, and so important for bridging the gap, especially here at MTV. That was really risky back then. We see it a lot now, collaborations and things like that. You know, a decade later, also gave birth to like Limp Bizkit and, you know, Korn and Kid Rock, and I mean, I think it influenced them wherever they was at.
Run-DMC made it cool in the urban community to really embrace rock music. That moment was definitely monumental in the whole game for us.
While producing Run-DMC, Rick Rubin worked on repeating his success using the same rock and rap formula, this time with the white New York-based punk band.
They talk about the Beastie Boys all day long. They don't even have a video. As soon as we do, they're gonna have to change it from MTV to Beastie TV.
You gotta fight for your right to party.
Rick Rubin, you gotta give him a lot of points because he basically put down some of the basic sounds of hip hop. That's hip hop.
Hold it now.
Not only were they some white boys that rapped and they were on TV, but they were fresh. They were like, you know what I'm saying? Like, oh,
I used to love the Beastie Boys. I still do. Matter of fact, I love them dudes, man. I thought they was wild. That's what it was about, having fun.
That's rap. That's hip hop. You know, I mean, it wasn't all about the color because they were white or anything. It didn't matter.
Beastie Boys took it to a whole nother level. I don't want to say they brought it to mainstream more than Run-DMC, but they brought it to the suburban audience just as much, if not more, than Run-DMC did.
Hip-hop was blowing up. No longer were artists striving to sell a million records, they were going multi-platinum. The Beastie Boys, LL Cool J, Salt and Pepper, and Run-DMC were an undeniable force. MTV responded, asking the Kings of Rock to host a pilot for a new show.
Welcome to Yo MTV Rap.
I'm DJ Jazzy Jeff.
Hey, yo, I'm the Prince.
Yo, this is Ice Cube.
Tone Low.
EPMD.
Third Bass.
Hold it now.
It's Queen Latifah.
Kwame.
Hello, Cool J.
Yo.
Going down in history as one of the highest-rated pilots for MTV, Yo MTV Raps quickly became a weekly hour-long program featuring the best in new rap videos with its stars stopping by, and was hosted by a familiar face in hip-hop, Fab Five Freddy.
Yo, we looking like home cooking.
Yo. My earliest memory of Yo MTV Raps is just seeing hip-hop on MTV. That was startling enough.
Follow me into a solo, get in the flow, and you can picture like a photo.
And it was also the way Fab Five Freddy would conduct the interview. It was conducted from not just a journalistic point of view. He was a part of the culture.
What's your names, y'all?
Bust the rhymes.
He was damn near cooler than the artist.
Yo, Rick, I see you got some fly jewels on, man.
I'm trying to hurt him, you know what I'm saying?
Trying to hurt him?
New York.
It's only, I got a little something for Manny's over there, a little MTV type thing, you know?
So, like, when you was going to do Fab Five Freddy, you had to make sure Fab Five didn't outshine you.
Slamming Cadillac doors and dropping 50 cent pieces in the piccolo.
Let's show him how it should be done.
Fab Five Freddy. That was my dog.
I'm Fab Five Freddy, hanging out here with the gorgeous.
So, and Pip is here.
Yo MTV Raps really made rap come into the households of suburban America.
When Yo MTV Raps first came out, I was in my early teens, and I was waiting for something like that to come along.
Get adjusted!
Kicking wicked rhymes like a fortune teller, cause the wickedness done by Jack, where everybody has the body and soul. Hey. For the liquor and the gold, smacked in the back for the other man of Mac. Huh.
When it did, I was like, this is dope, because it gave me and my friends a chance to be able to see, like, our artists that we were buying their records, be able to see what they look like. The style of dress, the way they move, the way they act.
Hey, you get off my class. You don't know me and you don't know my staff.
Ed Lover and Dr. Dre used to bring on different guests, and you know, you used to be able to see their personalities.
You can get with this, or you can get with that. You can get with this, or you can get with that.
Huh?
Hold on, take a work on this
Chuck Rock one, out here, man.
This is an EP, too.
Yeah,
come
man,
six
man,
songs,
I know you got Chuck
six
Rock
song EP.
Here, man.
Yo,
what
you chill, man?
Down on the whole tip, man.
You know, when hip-hop was really just limited to underground, you know what I'm saying? It kind of started bringing it to the mainstream.
And as the saying goes, you always remember your first.
The first artist that I saw on Yo that really, really inspired me was Queen Latifah.
Ooh,
she was a woman, and she was doing it, and that showed me that men weren't the only ones that could do it. Like, at first, it was just all men and male-dominated. When I saw Queen Latifah, I knew then, really, that I wanted to be a rapper.
I remember my first time on Yo MTV Raps. I didn't even look in the camera. I had my head down all the interview, and I was, like, real shy to the camera.
Snoop, tell me, man, lyrically, I mean, what was your whole flavor? Grab the mic. What was your whole, you know, what were some of the things that were inspiring you on this album?
The DOC, basically, because in the beginning it was just me, DOC, and Dre putting together the album.
They just caught me off guard. And before you know it, they had the camera in my face, and they was asking me questions, they asked me to freestyle.
It's like a one to the two, now swing it to the three. It's the S-N-double-O straight to the P.
He was a little nervous.
So, like, you from Long Beach?
Yeah, the east side where the grass is greener.
I was young and in the game. I was excited, but at the same time, I was nervous. But I had fun being a part of it, and it showed me how to gradually grow and learn how to, you know, do this damn thing.
The first interview, Fat Five Freddy on TV Raps. He was on the back of a flatbed truck riding through Compton.
Easy and the posse, they rented this truck. We on our way to Venice Beach. We gonna have a little fun, check out the girlies.
To finally get a rap show on the national level, it's exciting.
After seven highly successful years, Yo MTV Raps had accomplished its mission, blasting hip-hop into heavy rotation on MTV.
Check, going out with respect. This is the last show, so we gotta catch. Now check this out, I'd like to give a shout-out to Ted Demi for originating this whole thing.
You know, that hurt my feelings, y'all took that Yo MTV Raps off, too. You know, that hurt a lot of hip-hop feelings right there, man. That kind of... You know, that kind of turned a lot of people away from MTV for a minute when they took off Yo MTV Raps.
That's what's missing now. We need that again. We need to have that show on because it bridged the gap. It brought everybody together. It was a unity thing.
I'm not even gonna lie. The last show y'all did for Yo MTV Raps was hot because y'all had, like, so many different artists come on and they performed.
Everybody in this mother will get touched. Such and such, I roll tight like handcuffs. Rock that ass to sleep with this beat techniques. I beat that freak of the week like I made me deep. Hold up.
It was really special because it was the end. And y'all kind of brought it home.
Checking that one, two.
Excellent!
Check it. Now, artists that come through with the force, of course, and make the front cover of the source. I tell the world my name like K Solo and do promos and let the press catch my photos.
Whoever was hot in hip hop at the time and whoever was historical in hip hop, you had them all there and everybody got a chance to say goodbye to a monumental show.
I definitely have the utmost respect for Hammer. People be talking, you know, talking shit about Hammer, but run up on him.
Hammer beat your
Hammer
ass.
Hammer beat your
Hammer
ass.
Your monk ass. Run up on Hammer.
Coming up, the man that turned it out.
This here's a jam for all the fellas. Try to do what those ladies tell us.
You gotta know it's gonna go into pop culture. You know, you cook some gumbo and it's hot, it's gonna come up in a can some damn where. You just better know that.
Welcome back to Grab the Mic, MTV's 20th anniversary hip hop celebration. I'm Sway, and behind me is the historical East River Park Amphitheater, which was featured in the classic hip hop movie, Wild Style. Now, by the 90s, hip hop was no longer confined to block parties, basements, and parks like this. It became mainstream, and hip hop artists began to cross over into the pop territory, but no one artist made more of an impact than a guy from my hometown, this Oak Town native.
Uh-oh, all that. He brought a lot to the game, too, you know what I'm saying? The dancing, that was real big, because, you know, hip-hop was just known for lyrically. He put the dance in at the party to where the girls wanted to be a part of it.
people might dog him now, but you had your set of Hammer fans. Don't even act like it, you know, with the sag. Because when you did that, like, MC Hammer look move and wiggle and go over to the side, everybody did that. Hammer was hot.
I didn't like Hammer. You know, I didn't like Vanilla Ice, and I put them both in the same category. Most of the kids were into Hammer, and I was just like, I remember I used to just be like, why do you listen to this bullshit?
I definitely have the utmost respect for Hammer. He was a young cat that came in the game, did his own thing, did it the way he wanted to do it, and he succeeded.
Hammer was the first puffer.
You know what I'm saying? As far as like commanding like that big pop success over like the world.
Can't touch this.
Oh man, I knew that was gonna be one of the hugest records ever in hip hop, rock and roll, pop, in the country.
About him, right?
It's like you can't touch this.
Hammer was raw dog. He did his thing. I actually used to like Hammer.
I mean,
you know what I'm saying? On the real tip. People be talking, you know, talking shit about Hammer, but run up on it.
Hammer beat your
I bet you'll beat your
mother. Your monk ass. Run up on Hammer.
For real.
Stop. Hammer time.
Hammer did a lot for MTV. I know a lot of people was watching MTV during the Hammer days. Those videos were unbelievable. I would run to see a Hammer video. If I heard Can't Touch This coming,
sure, I remember when we used to be
flying to the TV.
On the road with him, remember?
Hammer was explosive.
Yes.
It's
hard to follow him. You know, with the dancing and the whole thing.
Like a circus on stage. He would have like four different things going on. He had a choir over here doing their stuff, Oaktown 357 doing their stuff, he doing the stuff, he got some guys over here doing the stuff, and he just kept you like this the whole time. For me, he like showed me what a real entertainer is, and I hope that he knows that he touched people like me, because I found a lot of respect in him for what he did.
Hammer was big, I mean, what? Can't hate on a man like that. Can't hate on him.
One way he was like Hammer the dancer, the entertainment megastar, and he came back because everybody started talking about how he sold out and everything. He tried to come back hard.
Gossip.
He came back gangster first though. Remember with the skull cap and the loafs on. He had that on, the pumps and the
too
bottom.
Legit. Too legit.
Yeah, too legit. He came back. He should have did just do what you do, whatever they say about you. For real.
Well, just do your thing.
Hammer's videos with their outlandish sets, special effects, costumes, and dancers prove that rap music can stand next to its rock and pop counterparts on MTV and open the door for today's big budget cinematic landscapes.
Ooh, I got you all checked. I think that video was a real turning point video. It went from straight hardcore to anything goes.
It was the first video where I think anybody probably changed about 10 different times in 3 minutes. And it was the first video that has ever used a fisheye lens. My performance was magnified, so it was kind of like the first real-life animated video. The first real-life cartoon.
The rain put it on a whole another perspective. This hip-hop girl come in, and she's rapping a different kind of way.
Now look who it be. It be me, and Timothy.
And then she give us this video like the black Linda Blair on a hill, or just she got on this patent leather suit, and it's like 20 times bigger than what she really is, so it's just bugged. It was just a bugged out video.
Visually, a lot of our videos used to be kind of grimy and whatever, nothing to them, and they, you know, they made you watch. That made you really want to sit down and see, you know, dang, what's going on here? You know, this is different.
Let me welcome everybody to the Wild Wild West, a state that's untouchable like Elliot Ness.
California, West Coast.
Pimpin', baby. That's right. pimping, spinning cheese.
Sicker than your average, pop a twist, cabbage off instinct. Don't think, stink, pink gators, my Detroit players, Tim's for my hooligans in Brooklyn.
Yeah, them videos is tight and they were all needed at the time, you know what I'm saying, with the crazy budgets and the fly looks and just taking it to the next level. But then again, somebody like Nelly, you know, then flipped the script and came with a low budget video, same with Cash Money, No Limit. And they put the game back in the game to show that you don't have to have a lot of money to do a classic video.
I mean, Snoop is definitely like a big influence as far as my music anyway, you know what I'm saying? His G-Thing video, I think, when him and Dre did that, I think they really opened a lot of doors up. They probably could have shot it for no more than about 50 grand. You know what I'm saying? But it's worth so much more now.
One, two, three into the four. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the dope. Ready to make an entrance, so back on up.
Before I have to pull the off the cut.
It was the first video that showed some real L.A. players having a good time and not mad and mean and grabbing a gun, or you know what I'm saying? That's what West Coast hip-hop was known for back then. And we just put a little imping in the pimp, and we just slowed it down and had a good time. And it's like this and like that and like this, and you know?
Cause ain't nothing but a G-Thing, baby. Two moped out G, so we crazy.
Yeah, when we did the Nothing But a G-Thing video, we went out and interviewed quite a few directors and what have you, and nobody was saying nothing that was turning me on. They wanted special effects and, you know, big shiny type videos and what have you, and we wanted to just to be a representation of us, how we felt and what we were doing at the time. So I just decided to direct it myself.
Everybody, come on, jump, jump, jump.
Coming up, we look back on MTV's coverage of the monumental, the controversial, and the tragic events that shaped the hip-hop community.
I think to the whole world, it was just like a sad moment.
The one thing that MTV has been able to do is bring other artists together. From that Daytona Spring Break, me, Busta Rhymes, Tretch, Pepper from Salt and Pepper, we were all hanging out.
That never happened. It was nothing like that. That many rap groups, MTV, same time.
I met Tretch, and then we just clicked. MTV, you did it.
Welcome back to Grab the Mic, MTV's 20th year anniversary. Look back on hip-hop and rap music. Now, if this place looks familiar to some of you, that's because we're standing smack dab in the middle of Times Square, a place that has become synonymous with MTV. In fact, over the years, there's been a lot of great moments in rap music here on MTV, a lot of them. Let's take a look back at it.
I'm sick of you little rolling boy groups. All you do is annoying me, so I have been sent here to destroy you.
He found so many people that look like him, you know what I'm saying? And they all walked from outside. They were standing outside like it was a line. That was really thought of well.
She is incredible. For me, as another female artist, she was definitely an inspiration. She's intelligent, she's beautiful, she was another dark-skinned woman, and I was like, woo.
Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg, live in the middle of Times Square, NYC, make some noise!
Still the beast bang, still doing my thing, since I left ain't too much.
Man, that was a tremendous moment in Times Square. I mean, they shut the place down.
Don't call it a comeback!
LL put on a great show. It was the first time that any established rapper like that came out with a live band and rocked it.
They're gonna show it? I hope y'all laughing in your homes right now at, look at the, oh my God.
At least I was clean. Could have been worse. I could have been funky beyond belief.
Jump, 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 jump.
Nah. The tribe's bomb, man.
Yo.
Definitely one of the,
I don't know, one of the
top five hip hop groups of all time.
Without a doubt.
Can y'all kick it out? Can y'all kick it out? Can y'all kick it out?
How are you gonna ban a record like this in the United States? Freedom of speech, man. I mean, it just made me wanna go in and make my records worse.
I'm fresh about my coma. I got my mama and my daddy and my homies in my corner.
I thought it was very cool that he did the song. You know, I thought that song was appropriate for what he was going through, you know what I mean?
It was very daring of him and very daring of MTV.
Murder was the case that they gave me. I'm innocent. I'm innocent.
That performance just made me look at Puffy as a real star. Like, you got Sting on stage with you, dog. You big.
Truly love. Check it out.
Just to know that they had just gone through the whole loss and mourning, and then to see Faith get up there and look so powerful and strong and just so dignified was amazing.
It's by the Spirit of God that it happened like that. Make some positive music to keep the light moving and keep it pushing on.
I thought this was America, people.
The deaths of hip-hop legends Biggie and Tupac raised the question, is it art imitating life or life imitating art? It also posed a challenge for the MTV News Department to remain neutral when reporting on the personal troubles of MTV's biggest rap stars.
I know when I was, you know, going through my case, I used to watch MTV and see how they tried to, you know, do me or whatnot, since the media really did me bad. But MTV didn't really do me bad. They like opened it up. You know, even with Puffy's situation, they let me see and understand what went down. So, like, oh, he's innocent. Whatever. You know what I'm saying? It's like you really get a chance. MTV is open, and I appreciate them for that.
I seen Snoop on MTV News the day that the verdict was won.
We, the jury, in above entitled action, find the defendant, Calvin Brodus, not guilty of the crime of murder in the first degree.
They showed the whole reaction, him putting his hand down in his head, and, you know, the crying expression, you know, his man that was securing him at the time, you know, they hugging each other and, you know, like they, the whole thing.
Y'all thought I was gonna get found guilty. So y'all had the cameras rolling and be like, we got another one. Here's a quick, oh, we can't use this. Y'all just had the flexibility of being there, because at that time I was like a new rapper in the game, and there was so much, you know, surrounding me to where y'all had that action to get inside the courtroom or get an interview with me, because I felt like y'all was the only avenue of releasing what I really felt.
Appreciate that, and I want to thank everybody that prayed for me and my league through this whole ordeal.
They bring to you at home what you ain't gonna get a chance to see, and even if you probably went to the courthouse yourself, and that's what I love the most about MTV, the way I maneuver the tactics of getting in the nooks and crannies to set up that little lens to capture all of this, the behind the scenes, like the fly on the wall.
I think MTV News is like one of the best shows.
MTV News, you hear it first.
I don't think it's particularly brutal, because see, MTV never could be too biased away from the artist, because if the artist came out of it, they're gonna wanna talk to you again.
Two of America's most wanted.
What do you think you're most known for, your acting, your music, or the controversy that surrounds you?
My big mouth. My big mouth.
I got a big mouth, can't help it. I talk from my heart, I'm real, you know what I'm saying? Whatever comes, comes. I feel so confident and so sure about the man that I am that you can watch me. You can watch me when I fall, when I cry, when I get shot, when I go to jail, when I die, you can watch it.
Hi, I'm Tabitha Soren with MTV News. Controversial rapper and actor Tupac Shakur has died in a Las Vegas hospital of complications from several bullet wounds sustained Saturday night, September 7th. He was 25 years old.
When I heard, you know, Pac got shot, it was like, okay, Pac got shot, he'll be all right.
Picture us inside a ghetto heaven, a place to rest, finding peace through this land of stress.
That I ain't mad at your video.
I like Tupac because it's like a lot of mystery behind him, for real.
I think I like the softer side of Tupac. It wasn't just about partying. It was like, I got something to say. It's stuff that's going on in the world and people need to know.
We gotta stop making changes. Learn to see me as a brother instead of two distant strangers. And that's how it's supposed to be. How can the devil take my brother if he's close to me? I let it go back to when we played as kids, but then
change. We lost somebody very important to the hip hop, to the music industry, period. And, you know, it was a very sad day.
With Tupac, you know what I'm saying? It was a crazy thing to hear that he died. So when it happened to Biggie, it was a little surprising.
Rap star Biggie Smalls, the notorious B.I.G., was shot dead by a drive-by gunman in Los Angeles late Saturday night.
We pulled up to the hospital and I saw the Suburban, and oh, it was just like shot up, and I just think that's the worst thing that could have ever happened. And I looked at Jermaine and he just didn't look right, and I was just like, oh God, and I think we all just like broke down.
It was horrific. As an artist, I didn't even want to rap anymore because it wasn't fun anymore. It was like, who do we have to look up to now?
It just was crazy. It was a real weird feeling, man. Because then at one point, you know, it just didn't feel like it was worth all of this. Like, you know, I'm pretty sure a lot of MCs was just like, we getting in this to make some music. Like, we ain't in this to be dying. I mean, I'm not dying for hip-hop music. I got kids. I die for them. The music is supposed to create a love universally. Music ain't supposed to kill nobody, dog.
Family, friends, and fans of Biggie Smalls are here. They are cheering, and they're paying their last respects to Biggie.
I was in the procession, so I was in the car, and I was seeing it as I was going by. It was like a real emotional moment. Then when you saw it on MTV, like the aerial shots and the side shot and the fans, that got to hear them and hear really what was going on. And seeing it on, you know, MTV, it was so touching that people really cared that much.
The future of hip-hop is going to grow, and I think that is definitely going to grow on MTV.
Well, I'll be damned. We are here in Japan and Chinatown.
When Wu-Tang was in Japan and they didn't know our language, and all them kids was there jumping, going crazy, and doing call and response, that was very exciting to me and the whole Wu-Tang Clan.
Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the runners.
So where do we go from here? Hip Hop's future up next.
Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the runners.
Hip Hop can be a positive vehicle to influence the youth and make a difference, you know, if you use it the right way and not, you know, overdoing it and over accessorizing and sending out vibrations of materialism.
MTV opened a lot of eyes to music, a worldly sound. They brought a whole different perspective of music. Multicultural groups are just watching us and people are watching us. So you are going to tune in, you're going to watch because we got the mots right now.
Yo, what's up, MTV? We live in Haiti. Haiti, make some noise! Yes, yes, y'all.
Welcome back to Grab the Mic. Right now we're in Harlem, 125th Street, a national landmark, a place that's rich in cultural history as well as great promise thanks to an economic resurgence in this very important community. It is neighborhoods like Harlem across the country that help provide the soil for hip-hop to grow. In the beginning, it emerged as a voice for people who had no other platform. Now it's a voice you can hear throughout the world. Hip-hop music has influenced everything from today's pop to rock to R&B as well as gospel, and its original style of fashion and dance has influenced everyone from Jennifer Lopez to NSYNC to Madonna. It truly has come a long way. Now let's take a look at its future.
You had to do something in hip-hop to be in the hood. I was saying I'm from the hood. You either had to beatbox, DJ, rap, do graffiti, break dance. Yeah, you had to do something in hip hop.
The South Bronx, the South Bronx, the South Bronx.
Compton. Compton. Compton.
Started from street corner and we took it there worldwide.
I think hip hop is just gonna get bigger and bigger. It's gonna move closer and closer to the front of the record store. Cause usually when you go in the record store, you say, yo, where's the rap section? You go over there, you know what I'm saying?
No matter what they say about hip hop, the one thing that it does do is bring like all different races and all different cultures together.
I just see hip-hop growing. I think it's unstoppable. I see it growing, going to different countries, getting more multicultural. I see collaborations with people from other countries, still collaborating with other music.
Better get that dough, sisters.
P.S., we should be together, too.
Can't wait to see like a hip-hop rap country song. I'm gonna call Dolly Parton and see if she wanna come do TRL with me and we can do a live Daisy Duke song.
Pretty soon rappers gonna be 50 years old. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna be people in wheelchairs. Talking about I used to rap, man. You know what I'm saying? Kids born and that's all they gonna know is rap. That's all they gonna know is hip-hop because it's the voice of the youth.
Like how the other generations listen to rock and roll that they old, we gonna be still listening to Biggie. Like, you know what I'm saying? That's gonna be crazy. You're gonna be like 70 years old, like listening to Biggie, and probably gonna have the old school radio station.
People thought it would die out in 5 years after Run DMC came out. You know, they thought, oh, it's a passing phase. Well, shoot. It's a long passing phase then.
People that said hip-hop was just a fad didn't understand it, didn't know what was going on with it, didn't really understand the passion that we had about it, didn't understand the turntables, they didn't know that these turntables were like guitars and drums to us, and it was, I used to run home to get on the turntables, fight over the microphone. I think they just didn't understand how passionate these kids were.
It ain't like classical music or something like that, you know what I'm saying? Something like people have to acquire a taste or something or learn to love or something like that. It's like instant, boom, I love this. This is it, this is for me. Now I'm gonna loosen up my jeans, I'm gonna give me some Tims, I'm gonna give me a do-rag and a ball cap. Oh, I love this, I feel so comfortable. Matter of fact, I'm gonna do this every day. You gotta
believe. First, you gotta warm up, you know.
I'm a shiny ass man. Let me go on and shine.
That's a big forehead.
I ain't with that makeup so I leave here and think I'm dead.
Y'all gotta get out.
Do I have to?
God, I'm an ass.
Throw shot, dude. Everybody looking at me like.
Yeah.
That's Steve.
What the hell?
Oh my God.
It's a bug.
Damn, that's.
What up, Doc?